Good morning and welcome to the seventh meeting of the Justice Committee in 2016. Fulton McGregor is delayed but hopes to join us shortly, and I believe, Ben, you have a declaration of interest.
Just wanted to remind the committee convener of my voluntary register of interest as being a non-practising member of the Law Society of Scotland, given that they're giving evidence today.
Okay, thank you. Item number one, are members content to take agenda items 3 and 4 in private?
Agreed.
Thank you for that. Item number two is our first panel, and it's my pleasure to welcome Sandy Brindley, who's the National Coordinator of Rape Crisis Scotland, Ton Halpin, who's the Safeguarding Communities and Reducing Offending Officer and Chief Executive, Marsha Scott, Chief Executive of Women's Aid, and last but not least, Susan Gallagher, Chief Executive of Victim Support Scotland. And can I thank you all for the written submissions which you've given, which have been very, very useful. And can I refer the members to paper one, which is a note by the clerk, and Annex A of paper one. Without further ado, I'll open up for questions from the committee. John Finney.
Thank you, Convener. Morning, panel. A couple of references have been made to the centralised initial case processing teams. Some of them have been positive because it brings about standardisation, some about lack of local awareness of issues. Could the panel comment on that, please?
Sandy.
Just turn it off. Oh, I'm sorry.
You don't have to do us. If by magic, okay. It will come on.
Okay. Certainly in terms of sexual offences, I think one of the significant improvements in recent years has been a move towards specialisation. I think that does sometimes come at a cost in terms of local connections with communities and organisations, but from our viewpoint, certainly in terms of High Court work, I think that specialism has been very beneficial in terms of the prosecution of sexual offences.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mr. Halpin?
Certainly the feedback from services, and SACRO represents all areas of Scotland,
yes.
From the workforce on the ground. There's a great commitment, an obvious great commitment from the Crown Office, Procurator, Fiscal Service to work collaboratively and jointly with us, but there's a reality as services become centralised, the further you are away from the centre, the risk of communication being less effective increases. That's just a fact. I think everybody recognises that. But there's no doubt that our staff are reporting. But if you look at the purposes of the administration of justice, you know, you've obviously got the element of holding people to account for what they've done, and the punishment element. And the other element is more person-centric about how do we make sure that we heal the harm that's been caused by that and allow people to return to what are very productive lives for, and potential them for many. And that the decision-making around that aspect when you have a centralised system is actually a bit weaker, is weaker, because you're focused on the process, you're focused on the efficiency and administration of justice, and those decisions about what other perhaps diversion from prosecution, maybe alternatives to prosecution, they need to have a strong link with what's available locally. And so we would highlight the fact that needs to be a real priority in terms of where the fiscal service focuses its attention going forward. And community justice planning offers some opportunity there.
Mr. Halpin, can I just maybe push a bit further on that? Because in your evidence, you talk about, it's believed the transition, in this transition, local knowledge has been diminished, and the bit I was interested in, local collaborative working has become restricted. By that, do you mean diversion from prosecution?
Diversion from prosecution would be one element, but also what other facilities are there to refer people on to. For instance, restorative justice would be one that I mentioned in my submission, but that's only one element of it. You know, if you are looking at working with community payback orders, for instance, supervision of unpaid work, and people who find it difficult to comply with the order, those discussions about what happens going forward have to happen at a local level.
Thank you.
I think I'm going to echo some of Sandy's comments about our happiness with the move to specialist competence within the Crown Office. And I think it's important not to confuse the consequences of that with perhaps the consequences of some other changes that have been made in the structure and operation of the Crown Office. I think specialism for us actually is sort of another way of saying that that the Crown Office has built some real competence around domestic abuse in their team making decisions about case marking and certainly in the establishment of a special prosecutor for domestic abuse. But I think that shouldn't be confused with the questions of centralism and decentralism, and I just want to say I think the Crown has had more successful and less successful attempts at trying to create efficiencies by both centralizing and then decentralizing. But I think that's a separate process from creating specialist competence within their structures, which are not just to be lauded, I suppose, from our perspective, but are absolutely critical to ongoing improvement and quality assurance in the organization in terms of the experience of women and children experiencing domestic abuse. I absolutely agree that decentralization has been tried, and I think that I want to just say I think the Crown Office has done a lot of problem solving around how to create structures that make the best use of their resources, and they haven't always got it right. But as an improvement guru, I will tell you that you learn more from failure than you do from success. So, but I think it's really important not to conflate the consequences of centralism and decentralism with specialism, because I think they're really been two separate pieces of work for the Crown. And I just want to pick up on the question of diversion from prosecution. And I think that one of the dangers of attempting to move people out of prison is that we have conflated the consequences or, you know, the way to approach crimes of violence as all one thing. And I think we have noticed that a very quiet process has happened through the whole system, and the Crown's only one small part of it, where an enormous number of perpetrators who are convicted of domestic abuse wind up on community payback orders, which nobody has really had a public discussion about, but essentially is diversion. And I think that's possibly, in part, a consequence of needing to find ways to move cases through the system more quickly. But unfortunately, in the context of domestic abuse, it's had some unfortunate consequences.
Okay. Susan?
Thank you. Not to conflate the issues already or even to regurgitate them, I would say that in our experience from Victim Support Scotland's experience, the centralisation work that occurred in the Crown Office from probably over the last 20 years was very, very welcome in terms of their strategic and policy making agendas. They have been very positive in terms of victims and witnesses issues. And I think that since the decentralisation of some of the VIA teams, we have seen an inconsistency in practice across the board, and that has caused us issues in trying to operate our witness service in the Sheriff and High Court. I would say, though, in addition to that, when we're talking specifically about specialisation and the case progress agenda, that those witnesses that come into court that are not facilitated through the route of VIA have no access to case progress information, so there's still a gap there in terms of knowledge and information being passed to those people.
Thank you very much. Uh-huh.
So is it fair to say then, looking at the type of cases, there's a bit of divide in perhaps how centralisation is looked, how cases are treated? For example, there's the joint protocol on domestic abuse, and that seems to dictate that certain things will automatically happen. But the vast majority of cases will not come into that category. Is there therefore an issue? I think maybe SACRO has picked up on it. More pro-arrest presumption in favour of prosecution, less autonomy on the part of the prosecutor?
Certainly, my organisation's view is that there is a sense that there is less autonomy for the Procurator Fiscal marking the case when you have the predetermined results of marking. Mm-hmm. And if you look at every case in its own light, and those who are closest to that case and professional around that case can make the best decisions around that case. And if those are predetermined by a policy decision that everyone will go to prison because of a particular offence, that doesn't consider the individual circumstances and the exceptions, which would, particularly in domestic abuse, where it might not require that. But you have to look at that case, and there are issues around a case where perhaps alternatives are appropriate, but they'd have to be very specifically risk assessed. They'd have to be absolutely agreed by those who are involved in the prosecution and the management of that case that is appropriate. But what we need to be really careful is that we impose solutions that are not the best for that case.
Yeah, I noticed particularly, Mr. Halpin, that you talked about local case management and how maybe there has been, you know, some local knowledge lost when it's moved to a centralised system. Other members may pick up on that, but and the large number of Procurator Fiscals marking papers. Could you maybe expand on the difficulties that can potentially cause?
Yeah, well. We have evidence, I suppose, of areas where we've had long-established services available. Now, I'm very conscious that it's hugely difficult for a national service like the Crown Office of Procurator Fiscal Service to know what's available everywhere in the country, mm-hmm. and I think that's a real challenge for them. But if you don't know locally what's available, you won't refer people to that. Mm-hmm. And we have seen cases where long-established services, after centralisation of case marking, the referrals as an alternative to prosecution, perhaps, and with young people in restorative justice, for instance, where those referrals have virtually collapsed and then we've had to negotiate going back. Other examples in the police notices, the fixed penalty notices or warnings, where it virtually became a process flow, a model. And you know, if you do this, you can get a warning, and that's seen as a disposal. But in the previous world, that would only be part of the decision. Another decision would be, and we'll refer you on to this service to challenge the anger that you've got or whatever. Yeah. And we've had to go back and discuss and negotiate that with the Procurator Fiscal Service, and they've been responsive to that. But there's a reality: when you take the decisions away from where they were previously made, you lose that local knowledge, and that what we're highlighting is that is a risk for them at this time.
Okay, thank you, Liam McCarthy.
I thought Marcia Scott was going to say something. I mean,
I'll maybe
tee you up because I think the point that Marcia Scott was making earlier about not trying to conflate the specialism and the expertise, which I think all of us agree was badly needed, with the expertise or the loss of expertise in terms of the local dimension and the local contacts, the local relationships. Is there a way that we could perhaps have the best of both those worlds? We've got the expertise within a centralised structure, but that centralised structure needs to work more effectively and in a more joined-up fashion with the local expertise so that we maintain those relationships and we don't lose the benefit of that expertise, which I think has been, if not lost, certainly diluted through the centralisation that's happened over recent years. Is that something that you think is achievable?
I think it's the best and most important task or problem to solve, to be absolutely honest. And I have to disagree slightly with my esteemed colleague to my left here, which is that I think when we were talking about the importance of specialist knowledge and competence around domestic abuse, that sort of contradicts the notion that it's the local team that should be marking the cases, because you know, what we're talking about is an expert group, folks who've had lots of experience and lots of training. And I think those are the two key pieces, however, that that are missing sometimes when you move out of the specialist world into a more a locally based team. So I suppose the answer, which is an answer to so many things, to your question really is, the best of both worlds would be that we would have specialist knowledge and experience at the local level, but I think probably the assessment was that that's not feasible given the resources, so they were trying to find a structure that managed to use this, the extra competence and training, and then provide that to the local group. I think what that does for me, and we've touched on it in our paper, is makes transparent the fact that no matter how many times you rearrange your structure, there is no way to get around the need for significant and ongoing training for and prioritization of that for both people on the ground and people at the center. I mean, the way that our system works provides some really difficult problems, like the time in which a fiscal has to mark a case makes it almost impossible for them to get a significant amount of local information into the process. And when I was in West Lothian, we saw that would cause real problems for the marking. And if we had more flex over some of that, then you would have an opportunity to use the specialist knowledge in the decisions to prosecute or not. But you would allow then, if you had more time, you could then allow the local knowledge to go into place about how, what should happen with the prosecutor and the victims in the process of that prosecution. And I just have to point out that fewer than 1% of perpetrators convicted of domestic abuse in Scotland go on to a prison sentence over 6 months. 1%. So it's really the presumption to prosecute is an effort to counterbalance what was seen as a negative assumption around prosecution and sentencing and domestic abuse.
Happy?
Did that answer?
I mean, I think it's whether or not, notwithstanding the time constraints, whether or not there's a risk that we overweight the expertise in terms of the specialism with the expertise that can be brought to bear at a local level. And I don't know how we strike that balance given the time constraints. I don't know whether Mr. Halpin, you have any suggestions.
I think I would go back. I tried to allude to it earlier that I think part of the solution here is the emerging local planning that will go in within community planning partnerships and the community justice planning. And if the Procurator Fiscal Service is fully engaged with that at a local level, then you start to bring in local responses to those situations, which does recognise the expertise nationally. And that is to be welcome. But there is still, even with that, there is still elements of this. There was over 20% of the men arrested in Glasgow who never appeared in court in terms of domestic abuse at one stage. There was so what happens with them, those local decisions, do we just wait? Because a lot of the services for male abusers in terms of addressing their behaviours, apart from the prosecution of it, only kicks in if you're convicted in a court, if you're prosecuted. So do we allow that percentage to just go back and increasingly carry on with their course of action, and then we intervene at a later stage? Or do we actually look at other decisions that can be made locally that can work with those people to challenge those behaviour as early as you can?
Okay, that's helpful. Mary followed by Mary.
Thank you. I just wanted to ask for a bit more detail around the issue of capacity in local services. And I'd be interested in the panel's views on whether, one, there's enough capacity and there's enough resource put into that capacity, but is there enough within the system and local services to adapt them to different areas? Because you can't have a one-size-fits-all across the country. So is there enough space, if you like, to adapt and change local services to really fit the needs of the people? And the other question I wanted to ask was around if there is an alternative to custody and people are being dealt with in a local area, is there enough work done with the victim in all of it to ensure that the victim knows absolutely what's happening to the perpetrator, why it's happening, to make sure that they fully understand and support what's been done?
I don't mind starting in the capacity issue, I do think it's significant that there's been such a huge increase, particularly in the caseload around sexual offences, and I think that's a similar situation with domestic abuse, and I think it is without doubt that that has put significant pressure on the criminal justice system as a whole, not only in terms of the Crown Office capacity. And I think, as most of us have said in our written evidence, that has created issues, particularly in terms of communication and information. The provision of the VIA service, I think, can sometimes be particularly problematic, and complainers don't feel that they're being kept informed, either pre- or post-conviction. I think there's more we could do there, and I would like to revisit the Solicitor General review on that area to see how we could improve this. I think another issue more generally is around floating trials. We're seeing being used more and more for rape trials, which is against the recommendations of the original Lord Bonamy review. So our experience is there's a huge issue in terms of capacity within the justice system as a whole, and that is directly impacting on people's experience of justice. And I do think it contributes to the possibility of victim withdrawal. So I think we need to think about how do we get best evidence within what is quite a stretched criminal justice system, and it has to be by keeping the complainer informed and supported and trying to reduce these delays that are being caused by capacity.
I would completely agree with what Sandy's just said there. From our experience, victims and witnesses' information in terms of being kept up to date is very, very limited. And sometimes the information that is provided is written in a language that's undescribable to the public generally. And that in itself is an issue, because as an organisation we end up trying to interpret some of the information that is there that has been meant to be provided to aid people. And that in its sense of providing people with an inadequate sense of justice, as Sandy highlighted, and a feeling that actually they don't know what's happening in the process at all. In terms of consistency issues and capacity, we feel very strongly that VIA locally, anyway, have not necessarily got the capacity, and a lot of that is to do with the resources have not been necessarily put in place to enable them to do the job that actually they are there to do. And that, in effect, has had a huge issue in terms of witnesses and the amount of information that they're prepared before coming to court, also throughout the court experience, and then once they leave. The information that should be provided to people is not necessarily getting through to them.
Specifically on that point, Douglas?
It is. I just wonder if I can ask the panel, we've obviously got a second panel coming up today, is the perception from victims that the delays and the lack of information is solely on their side, or is there a recognition actually from our second panel of witnesses today that actually the accused have similar frustrations for their own defence teams getting information? I just wondered, you know, it would be very easy as a victim to see that it's a victim that suffers in this, but actually we are seeing it's both sides of the process are suffering because of capacity issues.
Our experience in the witness service anyway, we have countless examples of where witnesses, victims have started to give evidence, and then suddenly, for example, there's been an issue that has meant that defence haven't got the information or the evidence that is required to enable them to look at things prior to the court, so the case has had to be adjourned. And that, from a victim's perspective, is very, very difficult, but they also can sometimes see the issues that the defence have not necessarily therefore got the information that they need. But to be truthfully honest, from our perspective, it's about the victim and the witness and their impact and their knowledge of the system.
Just follow up on that. I fully accept that, but do you think it helps in any way that if a victim was to see that it's not just their side that's affected, that they can see that the capacity issues stretch across the court? Because it's very easy as the victim or even as the accused to think it's only your side, and I'm not saying it makes it any better, but could there be a better understanding that these delays and you know, the capacity issues affect both sides of the argument? I don't know, I'm just asking the question.
Can I maybe just weigh in on that, which is, I think actually it's not, I think it's apples and oranges, to be absolutely honest, because whereas the accused has a defense lawyer working on his or her behalf to manage their engagement with the system, the victim doesn't. And so their experiences, for all of the reasons that you can imagine, are you know, vastly more difficult in the system in terms of not having a professional person who's advising them. If they're in the right place in the country in terms of the postcode lottery, they'll have a very good advocacy service supporting them, in which case they will have somebody who is at least able, although not representing them in the same way as a defense lawyer does, to help to explain the system and how it works. But so many places that's not available, and so a victim is at the mercy of you know, whether there's an adequate VIA service, you know, whether the witness service gets the information it needs and in a timely fashion. I don't think any of us, you know, can say hand on heart that more resource would fix all these quickly, but we know that it's necessary but not sufficient, probably.
My organization, as you can imagine, with the services, does work with both victims and offenders. And while I absolutely acknowledge the point that Marcia makes, and I recognise that, it is a fact that the issue of not having information does affect those who are accused of an offence as well. And you just look at some of the cases where you've been working with someone on a journey which is really challenging for their life as well, not to minimise the impact that it's had on others. But then you get a roll-up of cases coming in and puts them straight back to the beginning again or whatever. So the issue about is, does information affect both parties? It just has to be acknowledged it does, but notwithstanding the points that have been made.
Mary followed by Stuart, then Rona and Ben. Mary.
Thank you. No, it was just a few of you had touched on the VIA service, and that was really what I was wanting to ask and get a bit more detail on. I mean, you'd highlighted that it seems to be a bit patchy at best, and from evidence that we've heard before from victims themselves too, that seems to be the case. So it was just kind of, what feedback are you getting from people that are using that service and how it operates?
I think from our perspective, there is some really good practice out there in Scotland, some VIA officers who are really working very well at assessing victims' needs prior to coming into court and passing that information through the system. And victims themselves have said that they really do appreciate some of the work and the compassion of some of those officers in the local areas. However, that practice is not consistent. And what we find is victims saying to us they actually don't know who their VIA officer is sometimes, or the information is not getting passed to them. They're left not knowing whether or not the special measures will be in place when they come into court. They're walking into court without any knowledge of what's going to happen. They're getting support through the witness service, but the witness service, as Marcia said, sometimes has not been provided with the information to ensure that person's special measures are in place, and they're ending up getting a default special measure that sometimes is not suitable for them. So there are real issues in terms of practice and consistency, but I think it has to be borne that there are some examples of really good practice out there. It's not all a negative picture, but sadly for victims and witnesses, it really does impact on their ability to give their best evidence.
Can I just add a footnote to that, which is I totally agree with everything Susan said, but one observation, I suppose, on my part from having been relatively close to the coalface for a long time is that it's structurally, if you're a victim, you know, the way that our system is set up is that, you know, you have VIA in a very, you know, sort of tightly defined period of time. But that's not how victims experience the system. You know, they experience it from the first time they come to the attention of the criminal justice system. So we've created something that's almost not fit for purpose in terms of victims' experiences, because their support and their advocacy is, well, it's this person between this time, and it's, if I'm lucky, I've got somebody that's going to help me through the pre-court and the court time, but nobody to help me through the post-court time or what happens over sentencing or all of those things. And I think no matter how, with the greatest will in the world and all the resource in the world, the way it's structured at the moment is not terribly friendly to victims.
I would totally concur with that. The seamless throughput is not there for victims and witnesses at all.
Just to add to that, I think one positive development is the government funding advocacy services for people going through the justice system. So just last year we received funding to establish an advocacy service across Scotland for sexual offence complainers. So that's, because I think what complainers are looking for is support from the start, right through and post-court as well. It's a really important period, I think, where people are in need of support. But I think to make this as effective as possible, we need to make sure advocacy services have decent access to information. I know that our advocacy workers sometimes struggle to get information from VIA, which does make you think, how is that for complainers that are doing it directly without advocacy support? So I think we can do much more. I do think it's something that's been considered really in depth by this, the previous Solicitor General's review, and I think we should consider that.
Okay. Absolutely, because I think that's what strikes me. You just think if you were coming into that system for the first time, and obviously the trauma of what you're dealing with in itself, and as well as having to work your way through that and the different organisations that are being presented to you, must be really difficult. So thank you very much for that. It was also just in terms of the evidence that was given by Rape Crisis, and you highlighted about the use of sexual history and character evidence in the evidence there and how, but the most recent evaluation of that was done within the last 10 years. It's just really to hear a bit more detail about that, and are you proposing that another evaluation of that should be undertaken? Or
It's been an issue that we've legislated on twice now in Scotland to try and restrict the use of sexual history and character evidence in sexual offence trials. The most recent evidence we have about how effective it is now 10 years old. It painted a very worrying picture. I mean, really, the highlight, I think, or the key fact that came out of the previous evaluation was that 7 out of 10 women are virtually guaranteed to be asked about their sexual history or character in the course of a rape trial. I think that should concern us all. I think it's prejudicial, potentially, to jurors. It puts women off reporting, absolutely. I think we just need to look at the recent Ched Evans case, I think, which our view was it was a complete travesty what happened to the women in that case. So I think our concern is that we do not have an up-to-date picture of what's happening and how effective our legislation is in this area. We had some data from the Scottish Government, which we referred to in our submission. On the face of it, it's worrying to see such a high success rate and such a low level of opposition to these applications, but really it's pretty meaningless data without any context, because it is possible that some or many of these applications were legitimate or were made by the Crown, because the Crown need to apply to introduce this kind of evidence. So really, I do think we need to have an independent, proper evaluation of how this legislation is working. My sense is that things are better than they were 10 years ago, or certainly in terms of sexual history, they're better. I think there's more and more of a focus on medical records. Complainers' medical records being sought as part of abuse prosecutions, which does not happen in this way for any other crime. So really, I think we just need a much clearer factual base about what's happening. Is this legislation protecting complainers? And if not, what should we look at doing about that? I think it's a human rights issue.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Especially in terms of access to medical records that are being brought up in domestic abuse cases, it's very problematic. We had a call to the helpline the other day where a woman was asking for information and she was given it, and she said, well, I don't know if I'll call because they'll just lift me also, and then they'll be looking into all of my records to find my medical records, and I don't think I'm comfortable with this. And it has a hugely chilling effect on disclosure.
Absolutely.
I just wonder on that point if the recent judicial review decision by Lord Glenny has actually had any effect now. I'm told that should be up and running, and so advice is available to the victims.
I think the Lord Glenny judgment was very welcome. It only applies to the defence, and what we know is that many requests to access records are coming from the Crown Office. So I think there is still an issue there in terms of access to legal advice for complainers in those circumstances. I think it's really two stages. It's the access to legal, it's the access to medical records where somebody has legal representation if it's the defence, but the next stage is then to go through the 274, 275 process, and I think it's that stage we need much, much better information about. But also, I think that there's no point in having a right if we don't tell people about mm-hmm. that, right? And I think we need to do more. If a complainer is in the situation where the records are being sought, they need to be told where to seek help. I think it's not enough. We've had one experience of a woman just being told that a hearing next week for all your medical and psychiatric records, you need to get a solicitor. And this is somebody in a really vulnerable position mm-hmm. who doesn't have a lawyer already. Where do they go? Like we really need to put proper processes in place, but also I think we need a standardised form that really clearly sets out what's happening, because I think it is still confusing to complainers, and I think we're not telling them consistently they have this right to legal representation.
I think that's helpful. Stuart, followed by Rona.
Thank you. I've got two quite brief points, Convener, one of which arises from previous contributions and perhaps is initially directed at Marcia. And that was simply on the allocation of resources that are specialist resources centrally and locally. And I just wondered if you had a view as to whether in some of the smaller sheriff courts, and I'm thinking, for example, in my constituency, Banff Sheriff Court is very different from Glasgow Sheriff Court, whether there is sufficient business for some of the specialisms for specialists if they were to be located in a small sheriff court to keep up to scratch with their specialisms. And assuming you accept there is an issue around that, do you think the right balance is being struck? In other words, I'm suggesting it isn't simply about whether there's enough money for resources, but also whether there's enough work for the specialists.
Well, I would not sell myself as an expert on what all of the business is that's running through the sheriff courts, small, medium, or large, but I will say that it's likely to be at least 25 to 30% domestic abuse cases. So I think no matter the size of the court, domestic abuse is always going to require specialist competence. And there can be case clustering, there can be all kinds of things that make the process more efficient. But I think from a human rights perspective, we can't decide that people living in Orkney or you know, wherever with the smaller sheriff courts somehow have less right to have properly trained and properly marked cases and properly prosecuted ones.
Would that also apply to, have others got views on that? If not, it's okay, we'll move on. It's not compulsory.
Anyway. Rona, followed by Ben, then Oliver.
Good morning. From previous evidence, we know that a lot of victims and witnesses have they find the whole process of prosecution and being in the justice system very difficult. A lot of what you've said answers my question, but I just wondered if you could crystallise or prioritise the main issues that you feel still need to be addressed for helping victims through the system and witnesses.
I think from our perspective, one of the major issues was touched upon by Sandy earlier is that victims and witnesses need a single point of contact to come into the system. Potentially they only have to tell their story once. They should be able then to have a throughput through that system without having to regurgitate everything that they've ever said before to 47 different people as they participate through. They should be provided with a holistic assessment of their needs in order how to best to give that evidence. And we feel quite strongly that the justice system in Scotland could do far less and far more if it actually introduced such a system. And what I mean by far less is the bureaucratic notions that are in place at the moment and the administrative burdens that are on everybody in the system is quite substantial, and I think a lot of efficiency and effectiveness could be cut if that throughput was there in a meaningful way for people.
I just want to add that I think Sandy's point about advocacy services and sexual assault and rape cases is absolutely applicable across the field, which is that victims who have robust advocacy support have a better experience, have less chance that they're going to become part of victim attrition, less likely to withdraw and have a better sense, no matter the outcome of the case at the end, because they understand what's gone on. So an advocacy is not the silver bullet that's going to make it a wonderful experience, but absolutely, I think it's the very first and most important resource for victims, and it helps make that experience seamless, which it is so far from at this point. But I also think that there needs to be a higher, I suppose that communication with victims needs to be a higher priority across the system. And from our perspective, it's sometimes difficult to discern whether negative experiences of victims come through court processes, through prosecution processes, through police. You know, the way the whole system comes together, it's sometimes difficult to unpick exactly where you need to fix it. But I do think that creating a system that is centered around the experiences of victims would make the whole thing work better and be more efficient, as well as be more humane.
Can I just follow up on that point about good advocacy and just to put it in perspective, what sort of percentage would you say, roughly, of people actually get that?
I would not hazard a guess on that. I can go away and try and figure it out and take a look at where this... But also, it will change significantly according to offence. So I would guess that probably there's more domestic abuse advocacy available than any other offence, and it's not anywhere near adequate.
Okay, thank you.
Ben? Hi. Just to answer the question about what would make a difference for complainers, I think it's important to acknowledge that certainly in sexual offences, the vast majority of people who report rape never see their case get to court. If you look at the statistics, it's a very small proportion are prosecuted, and I think that does give lie to this notion that the Crown are prosecuting weak cases because of political pressure. Like, factually, I just do not think that's borne out, certainly in terms of sexual offences, and it is corroboration as the main reason that complainers in touch with us are being given. But for those whose cases are prosecuted, I do think cross-examination is the single most difficult part of the justice process. It's always going to be difficult. We need to test evidence. We're not saying let's just like put women who say they've been raped into court and accept every single thing they say, but I do think we could do more to get to the truth within our justice process and make it less of a memory test. If you look at the delays in cases coming to court, it's often at least a year and a half after somebody's reported a rape that the case has been heard in court, and so much of the defence question focuses on very, very specific details that are like slightly different recollections, which are completely natural. Sometimes somebody's given evidence about something that's happened 20 years ago. I don't think the current process enables best evidence in these cases in particular. I don't think they get to the truth necessarily, and I think this is out with the scope of the review into the Crown Office, but I do think the evidence and procedure review that the Scottish Court Service is leading on would be a really welcome approach to enabling us to more get better evidence and more get to the truth in these cases.
Thank you.
I suppose if we're looking at evidence and there's a problem with that being available at the appropriate time, that leads to delays, and it leads to very much the heart of our inquiry and what the Crown Procurator of Fiscal need to put in place. Very quickly, Ben Oliver followed by Douglas, and we'll try and make our responses and questions quite succinct.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, panel, for your written evidence. There's been much discussion already around communication, but I just wanted to touch on the support and protection of witnesses, complainers and victims. In the written evidence, there was mentioned from Sandy about the process of trial, and Marcia commented on not enough preparation time, prosecutors meeting with complainers, and the not enough intervening in the court process to protect aggressive or questioning. So I wondered if you wanted to maybe comment on that more widely, and also Susan as well. And on a separate point, Tom, I thought the mention of restorative justice within your evidence was really interesting. I wondered if you wanted to elaborate on that as well.
I'll be brief. I do think more could be done to protect campaigners in court. There's been a number of high-profile cases where, in particular, the Lord President has commented on the treatment of campaigners during cross-examination. I think, as we said in our evidence, it's everybody's responsibility. I think the judiciary obviously have a clear responsibility to manage what's happening in their court. But certainly our sense, and from working with complainers, is that I also think the Crown could take a more proactive role. It would, at the very least, if they objected, it would force the judge to make a decision on whether or not to intervene. I think what complainers say to us quite frequently is they feel that nobody's protecting them in court, and notwithstanding it's always going to be a difficult process, I think we could do more to protect complainers in these circumstances. It is the single most common reason we hear for not reporting to the rape to the police is what would happen in court.
I echo, I think, all of those, and certainly some of the judicial behaviour over the last few months that we've seen in terms of responses to victims of domestic abuse have caused us to come to a place where we feel that the system needs to change in that there should no domestic abuse case should be heard in a court where the sheriff hasn't had specialist domestic abuse training, because that sets the frame for the treatment of everybody in the room. And whereas we know we have limited influence over training of the judiciary, certainly there must be some way that we could take a look at how we can...
But we're going slightly off the subject matter, and given the time restraints, we've taken your point on board.
That's fine.
Tom?
The whole issue of restorative justice for me, my background, and some will know, was in a career in policing, so I've worked in the justice system through my whole adult life, and I'm now working in SACRO in terms of those who have caused harm in the system. So I'm not a soft touch, just to, and I'm not naive in that broad base of where I come from. My experience of restorative justice in Scotland is one where the country's almost split, and you know it's used extensively in youth justice with young people and lower tariff offences, and sparsely in the adult system. And there are areas. When we started this journey for myself, I had to a lot of fact-finding to actually have substance rather than it just being intuition. So was there a lack of evidence of its effectiveness? And you know, there is a huge point there around coercive power and its inappropriateness in domestic abuse, a view which I share, just to be very clear on that. But we've got to be very careful that professionals don't become gatekeepers to what people need in going forward. And the fact is that we all have experience of those who access our services, and there are those who don't feel that our services fulfil the needs that they want. And we in SACRO frequently have to turn people away who ask for restorative justice, victims and those who have caused harm as well. And I just feel quite strongly about this, that the UK Parliament has published a review last year in terms, because there was extensive rollout of restorative justice in England and Wales of where it has proven to be effective and where the shortcomings are, etc. So there is a body of evidence building up now. But I do think that there is an opportunity in Scotland. Sentencing has two parts. There's a bit of actually recognising what you've done and paying the price for that. Another bit is about rehabilitation and if you want to use the word redemption, moving forward. And this allows people the opportunity to repair the harm and to make peace and for people to move on in their life. And that's, importantly, has to be victim-led. And the whole process is voluntary. Anyone can say, I'm not taking part in that. But it's not just about benefits to those who have committed an offence, it's benefits to those who have been harmed by that offence. And I think there needs to be a serious discussion in Scotland about where we are going with this, because there needs to be a part in our justice system for actually repairing the harm.
Ben, did you want to
Very quick follow-up as well. Susan, in your evidence, you you made reference to a duty of care and on occasions where the accused has been let out of the building during a trial at the same time or soon after or soon before victims and complainers. I wondered if you could just comment further on that, how widespread that may be, because that sounds
absolutely. I was going to pick up on previous points, but in relation to protection and safety of people who cite witnesses to court and also during their experience within the court building, there needs to be the protection and safety of those witnesses utmost in people's minds. And what's actually happening is people are intimidated within the court building. For example, if they're sitting in a witness room where the door is open, they can see somebody outside that door who they feel are intimidating them. And obviously at the end of the court proceedings, as highlighted in our evidence, we've got countless experiences where accused are let out in advance of witnesses and they're then walking out to be intimidated and abused in some cases as soon as they walk out of the court building. So that in effect we feel is something that we should look at as a society in terms of the protection and safety of everybody as they enter and leave and within those court premises.
Okay. Thanks all.
And was it a follow-up on that particular point, Fulton?
Yeah, just a very, very quick supplementary for Tom, if that's all right. I'm wondering if he would be able to provide information on what areas aren't taking up the restorative justice to the same levels, and given the time constraints, I would be happy if that can be provided even to the committee after this.
I certainly can give you SACRO's position, but it's difficult because there is no central depository of where these services are available, and indeed because of the investment decisions that are made, they could be there today and gone tomorrow. It's not seen as a core bit of the justice landscape.
Sorry, it was SACRO's position I was looking for, as referred to in the papers. Thanks.
That would be helpful for us to see that. And moving on now to Oliver and Douglas.
Thank you, Convener. I know all of the panel have touched on sort of communication and efficiency. I was sort of specifically interested in the comments that SACRO had made in their written evidence around the potential for improved IT provision. And I wonder if that was something that, Tom, you'd be willing to sort of elaborate on, and if any of the other, anyone else had any comments, I'd be interested.
I'm sure all the organisations will experience similar things in terms of getting not just access to information, but timeous access to that information. And, you know, we're working on the principle that justice is transparent and open, and, you know, case progress and decisions made by the court being available, that those who have a real role to play can access it without having to ask someone where is it, and allow us to intervene expediently, is absolutely essential going forward.
Want to comment on that? And Douglas?
Thank you, Convener. Can I maybe ask all the panel, when someone you are involved with has gone through the court process, do you get feedback from them after every case, either immediately or sometime later? Because, Marcia, you were saying that, you know, there's a whole range of issues that could put people off, you know, they've gone through it, whether it's a communication. Sandy, you were very clear it was the court experience was the biggest issue that would prevent someone perhaps reporting a crime in the future or being called to give evidence. So how do you go about evaluating the experience? And I don't want to put it like that, because it almost sounds like a customer survey, but how do you find out how people have felt during the process, and who do you feed that back to? Or do you just store up that there is this great concern about the court process, the lack of communication, and really how do you disseminate that information with others with a view of trying to change things for the better for future witnesses?
It's a really important point. Certainly in terms of sexual offences, there's significant effort has gone into improving responses, but what we need to do is ask complainers about, has this made a difference? So at Rape Crisis Scotland, we have a protocol with the police, like an automatic referral protocol, and part of that protocol is we do an anonymous survey with complainers to go through their experience with the police and also forensic examinations, and we then do monthly reports to Police Scotland detailing what this feedback is, and it works very, very well because it means the police have a really clear overview of what the issues are, and if there's any issues coming up, they can address them. So I think that's a model that works well, getting proactive feedback from complainers and using it to feed into practice. And it's also something we're in discussions with the Crown Office about a similar possibility, because I think it is something we should be doing much more proactively, is seeking feedback from complainers and then feeding it in to both the strategy work we're doing, but also the direct practice of justice agencies.
I think that the protocol is brilliant, and the difficulty within domestic abuse is, I'll just remind you that there were 60,000, almost 60,000 police calls around domestic abuse last year. So we don't have the ability to take a more centralized approach, I think, because the numbers are so much bigger. So I think that, in essence, I think what you're asking is, how do we create a feedback loop in the system so that local practice can change quickly in response to what victims tell us? And I think this is an issue that touches on one of the previous questions, which is, there needs to be enough capacity in all the players in the system to do local multi-agency working, because that's how you create change. Create a responsive system. So if a victim has a negative experience that could be avoided, and absolutely I'm taking Sandy's point on board that sometimes it can't be, but that could be avoided either through improved communication, more timeous information, whatever it is, the only way the system's going to respond to that is if it feeds back locally, because they're usually not central strategic considerations. And I will say that one of the first thing that goes in a system that's stressed for resources is multi-agency working, because it takes a lot of time, but it also delivers the most important improvements in local systems. So I think that's a really important question for us to look at, is how do we improve, and how do we resource engagement with the other agencies? Because that's where you get that feedback from. Certainly the experiences that I had when I was in West Lothian told us that when that works, it works beautifully, but everybody needs to be at the table.
We also have quarterly meetings with the police and the Crown, bringing together all our advocacy workers from across the country, so that there's that direct link between the issues that complainers are facing and the police and the Crown, and that information sharing in that forum for raising any issues seems to work really well as well.
Let me just add one thing. I will say that
a little bit for time now.
Okay,
so,
I will be very quick. Okay. I will just say that our experience is that because we work really closely with the Crown Office and with Anne-Marie Hicks, is that we've had a really good experience when we fed back into the strategic level of the organization problems that we're picking up a pattern with. But I think there's a disconnect in part between what happens at the strategic level and what's then followed through at the local level.
Right. Susan and Tom?
Yes. We have a range of different mechanisms in place. Our witness service is there on the day, so people feed back immediately sometimes. Some people just want to get out of the building, but others will feed back on the day to our witness service, their total experience, and that is then fed into some of the local VIA teams, if possible. Alternatively, it's fed up into our structure, and we then use that as experience in some of our evidence and also some of the work that we do at a strategic level with the Crown as well. In addition to that, we as an organisation undertake surveys, and also I know the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service have also undertaken surveys, so there's quite a wealth of experience out there, and we try to use that experience at the different policy levels and practice levels that we have.
And Tom?
Ours would be much more at the person level. I don't think we're doing that analysis that you'd be seeking.
Okay, Liam, are you...
Just very quickly, I want to follow up Oliver's question in relation to communication, the availability of the information and transparency around cases. We've been made aware of, I think, one instance where the information provided to a victim on the state of the case wasn't just slow, it was actually incorrect, which is a sort of real concern. I wonder whether through better use of IT, that information could be made available not just to the victim and the witness, but essentially to anybody? Are there data protection issues around that, potentially? And to what extent are victims or witnesses expecting a bespoke communication of progress on a case, or whether that more generic provision of updates on the progress of the case may be sufficient to keep them abreast, to make them feel as if they are aware in a timely fashion, as all of you have referred to.
Wasn't a short one, but no. Important. Okay, good answer.
I think it'll be both. There'll be generic information that everyone needs to see the general progress, but there will always be bespoke, specific information for case for victims, witnesses, and those who are being prosecuted.
Okay. So the Crown Office actually piloted with Victim Support a case progress information service in Tayside for a couple of years, and one of the experiences of that was that the information was rapidly changing and the IT infrastructure was not in place to enable a smooth transition from Victim Support and also from the Crown, the Scottish court system, into Victim Support, so that we were able to update victims and witnesses. What I can say is, from the experience of the victims and witnesses, it was seen as a very, very positive move that they actually had somebody to talk to about what was happening. But the reality was, our member of staff was running backwards and forwards 3 or 4 times a day across the road to the court to actually get accurate information, because that information was changing. So there is inaccurate information that's out there, and people are being provided with it routinely. So an IT structure should actually assist that, as long as it's accurate.
Okay, thank you. Just before we close this session, can I ask you about the decrease in the use of precognition, and specifically, Susan, in your submission, you've mentioned that, which means it's led to unsatisfactory outcomes. Sometimes the Crown Procurator Fiscal not being adequately prepared, that leads to adjournments and so on.
Yes, we have experience of individuals who feel themselves that they have not been able to give their best evidence because they've not actually talked to anybody about their evidence in advance of coming into the court arena. And we know that in the past, when precognition has been in place, people have felt that they've been able to get some information across. In addition, there's also the aspects of the assessment not necessarily being carried out now by VIA, which has meant that people are walking in without that knowledge and without the PF and also the Crown able to look at that individual's needs. As such, they're getting special measures that they don't necessarily feel are right. And they then say to us they don't feel that they were able to give their best evidence because actually they're terrified. We've got examples of people who have been so distressed they've been unable to speak because they were expecting a CCTV remote site, and actually they ended up in court with a supporter and a screen because that was what was provided. And they said, I physically couldn't speak. I couldn't actually give my evidence. And therefore, cases potentially dropped or adjourned because of that.
What would be the reason for lack of use of precognition? Is it a resource? Is it a cost thing?
I think you would have to ask. I think, in our humble opinion, it is about resource rather than anything else, and people's ability because of the volume that's coming in now.
Policy decision to move away from precognition, but it doesn't apply in sexual offence cases. In most rape cases, precognition will still take place.
Yeah, thank you. That's been very, very helpful. If there's anything that you know, go out and think, oh, I should have said that, please add it. We're happy to receive anything else. But from people who are very familiar going in and out the court, that's been a very worthwhile evidence session. Thank you all very much. I'm going to suspend briefly to allow the other panel to take their places. Before I welcome panel two, I believe Stuart Stevenson, you've got a brief declaration.
I'd just like to declare that I sponsor Michael Clancy's parliamentary pass.
Okay. Thank you for that. It's my pleasure to welcome Liam McAllister from the Aberdeen Bar Association, Stephen Manfield from the Edinburgh Bar Association, Lindsay McPhee, Glasgow Bar Association, and Michael Clancy from the Law Society of Scotland. We've had apologies from Paul Nicholson of the Airdrie Society of Solicitors. Could I perhaps start by referring to one of the submissions, and quite well through it, I think it was the Edinburgh Bar submission. I'll just double check that. No, it was the Glasgow Bar submission. And I thought, you know, this was quite apt and it might help focus the discussion. Can I say at the beginning, the submissions have been so very worthwhile and have provided so much for us really to look and see where we can make improvements. But the line I was looking at, the paragraph was, obviously it's right that such serious High Court cases and sheriff and jury proceedings are prepared and prosecuted thoroughly. We are concerned that the standard summary cases are also accorded appropriate attention. The public undoubtedly would expect that serial instances of drugs, public order, dishonesty and violent offences are properly prosecuted by well-resourced and properly supported deputes. Whilst the very significant impact upon the public of High Court offences cannot be overstated, it is the case that many more members of the public will be affected by such offences generally prosecuted at summary level. So if we use that as kind of starting point, could I invite comments on where improvements could be made?
Thank you, Convener, and members of the Justice Committee. We're grateful for the opportunity to address the committee this morning, and thank you for directing me to that paragraph. I think it's clear from the general tone of the Glasgow Bar Association submission that whilst clearly we're extremely concerned that domestic abuse and more serious cases are prosecuted at a very well-prepared level, it is our experience in Glasgow that what I've referred to as the standard summary cases are the ones that are at the moment being very badly impacted upon by what appears to be a lack of resources, and that is our, it is the main thrust of the submission. As I think I outlined in another paragraph of our submission, the deputes are trying sometimes to deal with up to 10 to 12 cases, all scheduled for 10 o'clock, all with numerous witnesses. And as I think I indicated, what I've referred to as standard cases, as in non-domestic abuse cases, can include very complex and difficult cases. I think I referred to what are colloquially known as benefits fraud cases and perhaps sexual offences. A standard assault case, and I say standard to distinguish from domestic abuse, can involve child witnesses. So a standard domestic course in itself is extremely difficult, and we are concerned that these are being overlooked at in the current situation.
Okay. Anyone else like to add to the kind of day-to-day problems that you're experiencing?
Thank you. I would like to express my thanks for inviting me down from Aberdeen to speak to you today. I would echo what Lindsay has said. I think the resources are there. It is about where the effort, the time that deputies have, which is very limited, should be and can be focused. And I think the thrust of the very short and punchy approach from the Aberdeen submission was the fundamental point here that I think the committee need to understand in order to have an effective COPFS is that the discretion of deputes to channel their intellect, to channel their critical skill, their evaluation of evidence or potential evidence, and prioritising, the ability to prioritise at that very low level in a busy court with, you know, a fearsome sheriff breathing down your neck, that has to be where these deputes are allowed the opportunity to do that, and they're not confined or restricted to having to go two, three managerial levels above them to get authority to do that.
focus your attention on where they think the public interest is. I think that's very important, and so I would echo what Lindsay says in that regard.
In terms of going to someone above, is that because it's a short-term contract? The person who is dealing with it is relatively inexperienced and doesn't feel competent to...
I think that is a factor. That's the perception that the Aberdeen Bar would have, and the North East generally, that I think one of the submissions speaks about it, that we give deputes the power and the huge power and authority that they have to prosecute crime in our courts from a very early age. But we constrain that, we curtail it in certain cases. And I don't know why we do that. We should either give them the ability to be lawyers, to think analytically, to think like lawyers and act independently, or we don't. And I think there is a fear element, I don't know it, that's the perception that the Aberdeen Bar have, that there is a fear that short-term contracts, not knowing whether or not you're going to be kept on after a traineeship, because it's often second-year trainees who are thrown into courts up and down the country, rural courts where there often isn't anyone. They have to make calls, they have to adjourn courts to do that. These are all limiting the decision-making ability of deputies at a very low level and creating the churn that is so hated by witnesses, by complainers, and by accused.
And by churn, just to explain that term, it's a case continuing and being adjourned and reappearing again. Yeah. So if it was dealt with efficiently in the first instance, then obviously the benefits are huge in terms of freeing up the court and access to justice.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Yeah. Okay. Any other comments?
If I could just join in for a moment, convener. leaving aside the question of policy decisions for the time being, looking rather at the question of resource, excuse me, I think it would probably be reasonable to say that the types of resource and the time that is allocated for preparation for domestic cases, that's probably, in an ideal world, the way it should be across the board. The difference that you can see is that in relation to a court which is not dealing with domestic cases, which could, as Lindsay says, involve, for example, a complicated fraud, there might be a drugs case that involves forensic evidence, there could be child witnesses. The deputies that are dealing with those courts aren't being afforded the same time to prepare and engage and just make sure that the cases are ready to proceed. And it's always a question of finite resources, but if there were an opportunity to allow more time for those cases to be prepared as well, rather than taking away resource from the domestic cases, and I think that would be ideal. One thing which I hope is clear, really, from all of the submissions that the committee have received, is that we all consider ourselves quite lucky as far as the quality of the prosecutors in this country are concerned. There are a group of very dedicated, intelligent lawyers, really, at every level, but it's a question of putting them in a position to allow them to do their jobs to the fullest of those abilities, I think, more than anything else.
I think that's an important point. It's come very strongly through in all the commissions. This is not criticism of the deputies who are struggling manfully onward. And the whole point of the inquiry is to see what can we do to help them do their job as efficiently as possible. Anyone else? Let's see. Michael?
Thank you, convener. Yes, I think I would echo some of the comments which we've heard. Of course, Procurator's fiscal deputies who work in our courts day in, day out, are dedicated, hard-working professionals who prosecute in the public interest. And we depend, as citizens, on their hard work and dedication. And, of course, they are working, as Audit Scotland's report shows, to an extremely high degree, 88,000 cases prosecuted in our courts each year in the Sheriff Court. And, of course, that against a backdrop of a lowering of resource from government year on year. So between 2010 and 2015, the government's overall budget fell by 7% in real terms. And over the same term, the overall budgets of the Crown Office and Procurative Fiscal Service and the Scottish Court Services then fell by 14 and 28% respectively. Mm-hmm. So that shows that the staff in COPS are working very hard against very difficult circumstances.
Yeah, that's a point well made. Ben, questions?
I just wanted to ask on a matter that wasn't raised directly within the evidence, but I think it is of pertinence, and that's around expert witnesses. I just wondered if any of the panellists would like to comment on the process of calling expert witnesses, the cost involved, and whether you think, in terms of those that you represent, there is room for efficiency and development in that area.
Well, as far as the process is concerned, obviously the vast majority of defence work is done under and through legal aid. So it follows that the cost of, or meeting the cost of using expert witnesses is also met from the legal aid budget. In terms of the process that's involved, the particular defence lawyer would be expected to identify an expert, at least one expert, depending on cost. Mm-hmm. A specific request would have to be made of the Legal Aid Board once the costs were known for sanction, for funding to meet the cost of employing that witness, and thereafter the witness would be instructed usually to prepare a report and potentially, if there was a trial in the case, to come along and give evidence in the court. That's not always the case, because sometimes expert evidence can be agreed in advance, which would avoid that necessity. As far as the actual cost of employing experts, I don't know if my friends in the panel would agree with me, but I think anecdotally the cost of experts themselves is increasing. It is, well, taking a specific example, I think it's fairly common now. There is a standard allowance for getting a basic medical report from an accused person's general practitioner. There's a set fee. Now, for whatever reason, it's becoming a more common experience for general practitioners to respond to requests for reports of that nature and say, look, we're really sorry, but we're not prepared to do the report for that fee. And then the defence and, by extension, the accused person are left in limbo, because the report might be absolutely necessary for one reason or another in relation to the defence, but because there is a gap between what the Legal Aid Board will pay and what the general practitioner will accept as payment, you just can't get the report. So, I mean, that's just a very narrow example, but...
Thanks, it's very helpful. Perhaps I can refine my question slightly around the potential use of technology in helping to enable expert witnesses to give their evidence more more efficiently, and also in a way that's less more cost-effective for all involved.
Would I be correct in thinking that you might be asking about, for example, the possibility of experts giving their evidence by live television link or something of that nature?
Exactly, yes.
I think there's plenty. I'm just speaking for myself and for our association. I think there is plenty of scope for that. I mean, the use of TV links is something which is being introduced more and more, not just through actual court hearings, but, for example, facilities are now being made available for lawyers to consult with their clients who are in custody by effectively a Skype or a TV link. Obviously, it has to be a secure link because for reasons of confidentiality, but I can't see any reason why expert evidence couldn't be treated more often in that way if the expert doesn't live within reasonable travelling time of the particular court they're supposed to appear in. I think it would be important to distinguish between dealing with expert evidence in that way and, for example, a normal, if there is such a thing, eyewitness, because then there's the court will have more emphasis on assessing the demeanour of the witness in giving evidence and the credibility of the witness in giving evidence, which I think it would be fair to say probably isn't such an issue when you're dealing with an expert. Mm. So, yes, I think that there is scope for dealing with it in that way more often.
Thank you.
Yes, thanks, Convener. I think if one looks at the evidence which the committee received from the three medical examiners, Dr. Cumming and his colleagues, Dr. Henderson and Dr. Jimison, you get a sense of a cri de coeur here, that these experts are being put upon to do superhuman tasks. One person talks of trilocation as being a qualification for the job, and another talks of an incipient crisis, because at one point he essentially predicts that there'll be fewer and fewer doctors who will do this kind of work. He chooses to remain in this job, he says. So I think we've got to be aware of the nature of expert evidence, that it's clearly important with complex cases revolving around difficult issues across a range of points, not necessarily simply medical, but maybe in other forensic areas, such as forensic accounting or areas such as that, that we must be prepared for the future too. And now is the time to invest for the future to make sure that we get the right level of evidence, the best evidence on which the courts can make the decision.
Ben? Thank you.
It was on this point, a follow-up, maybe, was it?
It was on a point that was made earlier, and I wonder if I could perhaps come back to evidence in the submissions, particularly from the Aberdeen Bar Association, about the inability, I suppose, for fiscals to be able to exert their judgment. And I noticed the evidence from the Edinburgh Bar Association spoke of the leeching of the ability to use judgment. And I wonder if you could perhaps explain a bit more what exactly you mean by that. Is the removal to use your own judgment, is that done by diktat, or is there a lowering of the level required for evidence to take cases forward, in particular types of prosecutions? And on the back of that, if you are taking forward cases that you think should not go ahead, what impact that has on the perception of justice for both the victim and the person accused?
If I may respond to that, I think that is the fundamental issue that the Aberdeen Bar wish to reflect and convey today, and I think it's an important one. Unfortunately, the reality of our criminal justice system, and in particular our lower level courts, are that pragmatism and flexibility are unfortunately essential to have a system that works. There is a perception from the defence bar in the Northeast that there is an eradication of a willingness to make decisions at a very low level, or a willingness to use discretion. And the sooner or the more readily available it is that that can be filtered down to a lower level, I think that perception will eradicate. And therefore, all stakeholders, including the accused, will have a better idea or a better viewpoint that justice is being seen to be done. I think that can only be done as it filters down to a very low level. I think it's a very difficult decision to make at times, whereby you are being asked to be critical of witnesses, or you're being asked to look at it from a purely legal sense when you have the pressures of public perception behind you. But I think that's what's fundamental to our prosecution service, is ensuring independence and someone who can back them up all the way if that has been a justifiable decision. It can only come from within. It can only come from those higher up the ladder backing them up.
Can I just ask you then, on the back of that, if you don't mind, Convener, when you say to back them up, are you talking about then all the support services, all the victim support services, they should be on board with the reason why something isn't taken ahead, the support that someone will need to be given, and that they're fully on board with the whole process to be able to support someone if something's not taken ahead?
Yeah, I think it would make the decision-making process easier. And I think the more involved, I think that the previous speakers before the committee this morning all convey that the issue of communication is fundamental, and the more involved witnesses, complainers, victims are in that decision-making process, the more they understand what the legal constraints are, what our law actually is, the easier it may well be for them to understand why certain decisions have been made. That may often be the decision that no prosecution is made. Unfortunately, that's the reality of our system. That is just a practical reality. The more informed people are as to why such a decision is made, the better.
Useful line of questioning. It wasn't, however, a follow-up, so I'll be more strict next time someone jumps the queue. Fulton.
Each of you have said in the panel today that you feel that the summary court process could be better, could be improved. Could I ask what it is that you think the real-term outcomes are for people in the current situation? Is it that you feel that there's miscarriages of justice, that justice isn't being done, or that victims or those accused aren't getting the proper service? What is it you think for the public in real terms? Has the outcome of summary courts not been treated the same priority?
As a result of a lack of resource, I think would be the main one that I would want to mention. I think that's something that's probably mentioned in everybody's response. There's a situation whereby in any summary criminal prosecution, if there's been a plea of not guilty, there, some months down the line, there's a procedural hearing called an intermediate diet, the purpose of which, assuming that the accused is still pleading not guilty, is largely to check that both prosecution and defence are prepared for trial. And if they are, the case would be carried on to the trial itself, which would be a matter of a few weeks later. Now, just as a for instance, one of the principal issues that the court would deal with at the intermediate diet is whether or not prosecution witnesses have been cited to attend at the trial. Now, it's extremely common, certainly in Edinburgh, and I'm sure in other jurisdictions as well, that the information the court would be given at that stage is we haven't cited the witnesses, or the citations are out to be given to the witnesses, but can we continue on to the trial in any event? Now, the problems that creates is that you arrive at a trial oftentimes and the witnesses still haven't been cited, or a sufficient number of the witnesses haven't been cited to mean that the trial cannot proceed. And then, as a result of which, either the prosecution will be adjourned to later dates, or depending on the procedural history of the case, that's to say how many cycles of this procedure have been gone through, the prosecution might be brought to an end by the sheriff. So, just looking at that narrow issue, you've got a situation whereby either victim or complainer, accused, witnesses who have attended, and other people involved in the case are having the thing delayed for several months, justice delayed, potentially either for the complainer or the accused, depending on the facts of the matter. Or a prosecution which might be entirely properly founded is being brought to an end simply because the procedures, as far as citing the witnesses, haven't been done properly. Now, that would apply equally to cases where, for example, a piece of evidence hasn't been disclosed or a report hasn't been obtained. That's not always, it has to be said, the fault of the Crown, because they're reliant on other agencies to get these reports. But that would be, those are the types of problems that we have.
Just as a follow-up to that, during the last panel we heard a wee bit about diversion schemes and perhaps an inconsistency of their use throughout the country. You know, even just briefly, sort of one answer on it. What's your view, what's the panel's view on diversion? And do you think if that was used more regularly and more robustly, that would free up the summary court prosecutors?
I mean, I think it probably is an answer which would have to be given by members of the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service. it would be up to them, presumably, to decide which cases they thought were appropriate for diversion. But I think what we're finding in the summary courts at the moment, that there are a whole range of cases which, because of policy, wouldn't be deemed appropriate for diversion, racial offences, homophobic, sexual offences. So that, to return to the point that a standard summary court can contain a whole array of these cases which presumably have not been deemed appropriate for diversion. I'm slightly going back to answer another point that, to alleviate perhaps some of the pressure on the summary courts, if the Crown Office and Procurative Fiscal Service perhaps had a clear structure of how senior you have to be before a decision could be taken in terms of discontinuation of proceedings, or we wouldn't have a situation where a relatively young deputy was saying, well, I can't make that decision, or I'll have to go and ask someone more senior. If there could be a structure in place where a defence agent could identify in advance that, okay, I have to go to a rank of a senior deputy to make this submission to them to decide whether a decision can be taken in this case, that might alleviate some of the pressure on the deputies in court.
Clarify, it's not maybe to free up court time, but a more appropriate referral and disposal, so that's dealing adequately and properly and efficiently in the best way with that individual's particular needs, which means that hopefully they don't reoffend and they don't appear back in court. I think maybe that was the point that was being made about these referrals and diversions not being even at local level, even aware of what's available there, which is a huge resource wasted.
That's absolutely right, Convener, and that takes us back to the problem of having rigid prosecution policies, because you're in a situation where there's I'm using domestic cases as an example, because it's a huge issue in terms of resources and as a problem across Scotland as a type of crime. But there's a situation whereby, for example, a 70-year-old, we'll say a 70-year-old man with no previous convictions, no history of police call-outs to the house as a result of any domestic complaints. There might be a situation where neighbours overhear a loud and quite aggressive argument between the gentleman and his wife of equally good character and age. They call the police. The police attend. The married couple explain to the police what's happened. They've no reason not to. They don't think that either of them has done anything wrong. But that then amounts to and is classified as a domestic incident. Now, the issues that then stem from that are the policy is that that person will be arrested. If it's on a Friday evening, that person will be arrested and held in custody all the way through to a Monday, whereas somebody who perhaps has three or four criminal convictions has been arrested in the centre of town for involving themselves in drunken violence might be released on a police undertaking or even just kept overnight at the police station until they sober up. So it's entirely right and proper that domestic crime is taken seriously, is prepared properly and is prosecuted to the fullest extent of the law. But the problem in having rigid policies about how they're dealt with is that's the type of situation that arises. Now, I know that sounds like an extreme version of it, but it's not as uncommon as you would like to think.
Okay. Michael Clancy.
Thank you, Convener. The issue, of course, of diversion was identified in the Audit Scotland report again last September. And they identified that, of course, there were police officer alternative measures as well as decisions by cops. And when they gave the statistics on that, it amounts to something like 50% of all cases. So they dealt with a quarter of a million individuals, and over and 50% of them, 126,000 of these individuals received a non-court disposal. So it's quite obvious, Mr. McPherson, that if all those cases went to court, there would be considerable difficulties.
If I might add to answer Mr. McPherson's question more fully that
I think it was actually Mr. McGregor.
Oh, sorry, I do apologise. I think as the Crown Office Procurator Fiscals or FDA Union have indicated, the profile of cases now reaching court and proceeding to trial can involve very complex and difficult cases, the nature of which they're likely to proceed to trial. So just to follow up, that means that many more cases are going to proceed to trial. There won't be a ready acceptance of responsibility for the nature of cases that are being prosecuted, which I think makes perhaps diversion more difficult.
Okay, Gladys. Douglas, followed by... not after the last experience. We can keep it and bring it in at the end. Douglas, followed by Liam, then John and Rona.
Thank you, Convener. Can I ask about centralisation in terms of the communication? Because all of the submissions have mentioned, Glasgow mentioned specifically about the cost of the hotline that you have to call to contact solicitors. You all mentioned, or certainly Edinburgh mentioned, that you just take it for granted that your first letter will go unanswered, which I think is despicable. You know, it's unacceptable, and I'm particularly worried to read that. But then I also read in the Glasgow submission, you say there have been discussions about this. I thought, okay, we're trying to solve it. Discussions have been ongoing for 5 years. You know, really, how can we have any credibility that changes will happen if these things are highlighted when you've been ongoing for so long? And really, could you expand more on the difficulties that you experience with this?
If I could perhaps echo Stephen's comments that we have a massively positive working relationship with the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service in Glasgow. They're all extremely hard-working, dedicated professionals. We have a great deal of professional respect for them. And I think, as I highlighted in our submission, it's a very difficult situation for a young deputy to be in, standing before a sheriff, being asked to explain why a letter hasn't been answered or a phone call hasn't been returned. Sometimes the deputy's even unaware that the letter been sent, and there is a will to try and resolve these issues. The plea hotline was set up after discussion, and it works well for a while, and then the deputies are deflected to do other business. You know, they have to go into court. There just isn't anybody there to man the phones or to deal with the numerous pieces of mail. It is the case, unfortunately, that we telephone a business rate line and to the call centre, and it seems like a very basic and pedestrian point, but we are told specifically by the call centre operator we are not allowed to give out the direct dial number for the young or any procurator fiscal. I have to stress that if you meet the fiscal the following day in court, they'll say, of course, here's my direct dial number, I'll text it to you. There is no unwillingness on their part at all. But it makes it very difficult.
It makes it very difficult for me to understand then that there's been a problem ongoing for 5 years,
yes,
when both sides seem to agree that direct contact is the best way forward, because it then saves the fiscal deputy being embarrassed in court.
Yes.
The fact that a letter has been sent to them, scanned into some central, yes, reserve that they never see, yes, yet this has been ongoing for so long. You've got both sides agreeing the way forward, but you've got someone sat in a call centre not willing to give, yes, out any information. Surely it shouldn't be that difficult to say, well, there's the problem area there in the middle at this,
yes,
business rate number. Let's you know, take away that function, yes, or just go direct. Because presumably if you've dealt with one
yes,
fiscal deputy in the future, you don't then call this number, you call them direct.
Yes, that's correct. We just store their number, yeah, and then I think it would have to be a much wider policy decision that these direct dial numbers can be given out, and there's clearly not, you know, it clearly can be done. I think, as I highlighted, in terms of the solemn case structuring at the moment, the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service in Glasgow came along in advance of the practice note, and we now have a sheet of numbers designated, or with the designated fiscal with their contact number, which makes a world of a difference. So I don't think there shouldn't be any reason why that can't be done in summary cases. So I fully agree that it's very puzzling why it's not been rectified before now.
And the willingness of fiscal deputies to give out their own number is replicated across the country.
Sorry, yes, absolutely.
I mean, the switchboard, often it feels as if it's a barrier, a deliberate barrier that you have to get through in order to communicate with somebody about a case. It's not something which I think has helped at all. I'm not sure what costs are involved in having it. I suspect that it might actually be even more expensive to have the thing rather than simply have people dealing with their local offices. I don't have the figures that are involved in that, but it doesn't seem to me to serve any useful purpose.
I would echo all the comments and observations made by the panel regarding centralisation of communication. It doesn't work. It has to be on a regional, on a local level. Our very system is based upon a defence lawyer and a prosecutor standing up in court communicating with each other in whatever form that may be. But again, echoing the fact that procurator fiscals want to interact with defence agents. They want to resolve matters quickly for everyone concerned. They want to get things resolved if they can be. Communication is a major factor. One of the things that has been introduced is the CJSM secure email. I have not, the Aberdeen Bar's experience has been that has not been overly positive. If you're sending letters by first class mail and they're not getting placed into the relevant files when deputies appear in court, we're finding exactly the same process is happening with what is supposed to be a far more secure, far more technologically advanced, the way that we all want to move towards, you know, a more sensible option is using email. We all use it now in our private practice. It's becoming so important, yet there are breakdowns there where emails that are supposed to have, that have been securely sent, are not finding their way to a lawyer, i.e. a procurator fiscal deputy, who can analyse the content of it and make a decision that will help avoid churn, that will help avoid trials going to trial that don't need to go to trial, and will resolve things for everyone concerned, not just the accused, but the complainers, witnesses and victims.
Could I move on to another issue in the Edinburgh submission about, it was reported in the press over the weekend about the court system, you know, the backlogs, impact that has on witnesses, both the victims of crime, police witnesses, and also the impact it will have on the accused and such like. And you make the point, or it was certainly put across in response to some of that criticism, that, you know, the management is as good as it can be. You know, they try their best to manage the cases. Yet the Edinburgh submission says, when it appears five or even six backup cases have been called, it is clear that mismanagement is at play. I know that's particular to, you know, when you have the two-week period, but could you just give a bit more information on the management side, generally, in courts, you know, across your areas, and also maybe more for Aberdeen, I'm not sure, perhaps Edinburgh as well. Could I ask how much of an impact there's been with the closure of some of the more local courts and then the caseload going on to other courts?
Well, in terms of management, if I could deal with the last matter that you raise first, just to do it the wrong way around, the closure of, for example, Haddington Sheriff Court in our own jurisdiction has had a massive effect, because the portion of the Edinburgh Bar's submission which talks about mismanagement of solemn cases, that's the, I think, the portion that you refer to, Edinburgh is now dealing not only with all of the sheriff and jury or more serious cases for the Edinburgh area, but also all of the more serious cases for East Lothian, which previously would have been dealt with at Haddington, at least the majority of them would have been dealt with in Haddington. As far as general mismanagement is concerned, there are big differences between the procedures that are involved for summary cases and for solemn cases. I mean, that much is self-evident. As far as summary cases are concerned, overloading of trials courts is a problem. That's not something that was specifically raised in our submission, because it's not just a matter that is linked to COPFS, but also the Scottish Court Service and just the court resources that exist. So I don't think it would be fair particularly to criticise them for that. As far as sheriff and jury cases are concerned, there might be 10 or 12 cases marked down for a two-week sitting of the court. The deputies are, I know, under pressure to actually run trials during that two-week period. But there's almost a scattergun approach in terms of, well, we'll just call in four or five cases, see what witnesses are here, and then we'll pick one and crack on with it. the fact that I find myself using the word scattergun in that description, I think, will give you an idea of the type of problem that's involved.
I don't know if Aberdeen wanted to mention about the local. I'd be interested in that as well.
Yeah, I think clearly in Aberdeen we've been affected by the closure of Stonehaven Sheriff Court, and the volume of business in Aberdeen has increased. I think Aberdeen, the court service, has a good approach to trying to handle that. I don't think the apparent saving that has been or would have been would have resulted in the closure of Stonehaven Sheriff Court has then been filtered back or fed back in to the resources that the COPFS should have to tackle the increased volume of business. I would say the majority of that volume of business is at the lower end of the scale, the Justice of the Peace and Summary Court, Sheriff Summary Court business. But I don't think it's been the COPFS have been given the additional support. That's the perception from the Aberdeen Bar, I would say, that the closure of Stonehaven as a sheriff court in of itself has caused. I think there was a very, very sensible recommendation made before the closure of Stonehaven Sheriff Court, and that was, and I think touching upon Stephen's point, the jury business in Aberdeen is significant. Stonehaven Sheriff Court would have been an ideal court to sit permanently, and there would have been enough business. There would have been enough business for Stonehaven Sheriff Court to sit regularly, daily, conducting jury trials, taking the strain off of the Aberdeen Mercantgate building, which Aberdeen being a centralised area, there is a high court sitting in Aberdeen almost all the time. That's another court that we do not have, to have sheriff jury court business. So there has been an effect in terms of volume of business. Has that been reflected in COPFS being given the resources to manage that in Aberdeen? No, is my respectful submission on behalf of the Aberdeen Bar.
Could I ask a final question, sorry, very briefly, on agreeing evidence? And what's the biggest challenge to agreeing evidence? Is it the communication issues we were speaking about before? And how do we overcome that? Because it seems, again, that there should be will on both sides to agree evidence, to speed things up, to save some witnesses coming in. I particularly often look at police officers who spend a lot of time waiting around courts rather than out on our streets to just read out of their notebook evidence that really should be agreed beforehand. And I noticed in the submission from Edinburgh again, you know, the example of CCTV evidence that could almost, you know, do away with the need for a trial if it was presented earlier rather than often on the day. So could you very briefly, to keep in the convener's favour, give an answer to that?
Communication, as you see, is the main issue. And to touch on the speakers who were addressing the committee earlier, in terms of keeping witnesses and complainers informed, the earlier that the Crown and the Defence communicate to resolve issues, the better for the witnesses and the complainers. And I think the example given by the Edinburgh Bar Association with regards to CCTV is very appropriate, because as I think Edinburgh indicated, immediately the item of disclosure is available, it will decide often the issue one way or the other. And as soon as the Crown and Defence can speak to each other about the agreement of evidence, that could save a huge amount of court time and witness expense and inconvenience. But again, it returns to the issue of resourcing and communication. I think there have been significant improvements in solemn business in Glasgow in terms of communication because resources have been directed there in advance of the practice note being issued. And this was the practice note issued by the Lord President and Lord Justice General, who was at that point the Lord Justice Clerk. And there is now a focus upon pre-trial preparation prior to the first diet and to focus on issues of agreement of evidence, which can then be reported to the sheriff at the first diet, that now witnesses 5 to 9 are no longer necessary for the trial. So if similar resources were directed to the summary courts, there could be similar savings accrued there.
Yeah, that's a late production potentially that can cause all the problems and all the benefits not being realised. Whose duty is it to make sure that CTV is available and got from the police, if you like?
There's a process. Yes. It's COPFS who'd be obliged to ensure that the evidence was ultimately available. Yeah. But again, it's a situation where they are pressure. Reliant on the police, who have to gather the CCTV evidence from the witness or the location where the footage was filmed. Mm-hmm. So there's a chain of responsibility, but ultimately the responsibility would lie with COPFS in that regard. I think just on this particular point, it's only fair to make mention that it's a problem which it's plain COPFS are aware of. I know that inquiries are being made into the viability of, forgive me if I don't get the terminology absolutely right, but I think a virtual evidence vault, whereby when the police take possession of CCTV, it would be uploaded to a secure system to which access could be allowed at an early stage, both to the Crown and the defence. And I think by of necessity, the Crown would get first access to it. But if that's something which can be brought into existence, and it's very much only at the talking shop stage, I think that's something which would help. So that's, okay. I think it's totally fair.
These are good practical examples of things that, you know, we can focus on and highlight. Finished, Douglas. Liam, John, followed, if you've still got your follow-up, Mary.
Thank you, Convener. I think Douglas has helpfully gone over some of the ground in relation to centralisation and also the closure of sheriff courts, which I think have given rise to some concern. But following on the point in relation to the opportunities in terms of encouraging more agreement on evidence prior to cases coming forward, there seems to be a view that's been expressed to us over recent months that there's quite a bit more scope there to make improvements. I think from what you've said, I'm getting the feeling that you don't necessarily share that view that there is a great deal more that can be done, or that it would have a great deal of an impact in terms of improving the efficiency of the work of our court system. Is that a fair conclusion to draw?
Depends on the nature of the case. You know, if on a case where it's dependent upon eyewitness evidence and the matter of perception of the witnesses and their demeanour, then that won't be capable of agreement. But if it's a case where I think it's been touched upon, where expert witness evidence might be to speak to specific issues of fact, then that no doubt it could be ripe for agreement. It might be helpful to explain that the trigger in every summary case for disclosure of the crime case is what's called the letter of engagement. And as soon as the letter of engagement is received by the Procurator Fiscal, which denotes that a defence agent is instructed for that accused, then the disclosure is then uploaded and we can receive it. And the sooner that is received, then identification can be made of which areas of evidence are capable of agreement. So certainly, you know, I don't see any difficulty with there being more use of agreement of evidence dependent upon the nature of the case, but it comes back to the trigger of everything being available for the intermediate diet, which is the calling of the case before the trial. And at that stage, it is the case that the Procurator Fiscals will say, well, is the evidence of witness Y capable of agreement? And providing the disclosure is in your hands and you've had an opportunity to discuss it with the client, then an answer can be given then and there, and that witness not necessary for that witness to be called.
Some of the problems that the court system is struggling with at the moment would defeat some of the aspirations in relation to earlier disclosure as it currently stands.
Yes, yes.
I mean, Lindsay makes a good point that the sooner you have the evidence in your hands, or the sooner in proceedings that you have access to it, the better able you are as a defence solicitor to assess whether the evidence is capable of agreement. If, for example, as it unfortunately is not unknown, you arrive on the morning of a summary trial and you're passed something across the table I don't mean immediately before the trial begins, but on the morning of the trial, oh, such and such a witness can't attend today for whatever reason, it might be a police officer who's on other duties or really anything, can you agree their evidence? Then in those circumstances, unless it was something very, very, very straightforward, you're almost duty-bound to say, no, I'm afraid I can't, because you're not in a position then to have properly considered it in the context of the evidence, and whereas if you'd had it before the intermediate diet, you could have dealt with it. If, for example, the evidence couldn't be agreed, you might have been able to postpone the trial at that stage rather than get all the way to a trial with witnesses having been cited and attending court with all the attendant expense and worry that's involved in that. Mm. So to cut a long story short, the sooner we have the evidence, the better able we would be to consider agreement, and the more evidence probably that could be agreed.
Just as a final observation to the point of agreement of evidence, something I think the committee has already picked up on in light of the previous speakers and panel was precognition and the lack of it, rather, in COPFS in the majority of cases. There is an agreement, there is a duty on not only defence agents but on the Crown to agree evidence, and that includes the defence evidence. And there is often not there is not enough time for deputes to consider defence evidence properly. That might sound perverse, but they're focusing on their own case. A lot of court time could be cut down if they were given the time to precognose, to consider the defence evidence, be it defence productions, witnesses, experts. Or there may be, I think Mr. Ross made the point, that police officers are called to give evidence where it doesn't seem like there's a lot of dispute in what they are saying or adding. It might be there are just some matters that a very short precognition by the deputy might avoid that police officer having to come to court at all. It could be drafted in the form of a joint minute. Something could be clarified, a very small point, a paragraph or two could be clarified, and that witness is no longer needed. So there is an onus on both the Crown and the defence to agree evidence, but often we forget that because of a lack of time to consider all the evidence, i.e. the defence evidence, fiscals don't have the time to consider it. They just think, well, the onus is on you to lead it. On you go.
Whilst these concerns which we've heard are genuine and immediate, we ought not to forget that there is an ongoing evidence and procedure review which is looking at smartening up the summary justice system, and the use of technology is going to be a key issue in all of that. And if I can hopefully inspire colleagues to look to sunny uplands in the future, you know, the use of digital captured evidence, documents, photographs, CCTV, the whole gamut would improve the agreement of evidence procedure immeasurably. And I think we've got to encourage the Courts and Tribunal Service to take on the challenge which the Lord President issued to have clear sky thinking, and that would also involve changes to procedure and changes to the way in which the evidence of children and vulnerable witnesses is captured and used. And I think that the space which we can get to where the courts are more efficient is not now. It's not happening at this moment, but we have hopes that it will happen in the future.
With that, I know, yes, there is this procedure, and in many ways, when we've talked to the Crown informally, then high hopes for IT, but isn't a panacea for everything. And I think you mentioned, Mr. McAllister, the emails, you know, you're doing more, but if there isn't the man or people there to direct that, there's still very much a resource issue about using and having the manpower to use the technology properly.
Absolutely, and I would refer to my comments at the start of the session where we're talking about cuts in budget rather than expansion of budget. Sure. But it might be that efficiencies saved in the future through the use of IT, proper use of IT by people who are trained appropriately, and a complete buy-in by those who collectively participate in this process, that may well result in efficiencies which can be applied elsewhere.
Yeah. Very briefly, Mr. Douglas, I'm letting this session go on. This is really the evidence we're getting from you who are using the courts, who are at the coalface every day, is absolutely essential. So I consider this a really important evidence session. Therefore, I'm going to continue it until the members are satisfied with the questions.
Thank you, Convener. Just very briefly to Mr. Clancy.
Jonah.
I was more encouraged by your verbal statement than what you'd written in your written submission, because you seem very pro the use of technology, yet you have a caveat in your written submission about issues such as internet poverty don't disadvantage certain groups in society.
Indeed.
Could you maybe marry up your positive comments from a couple of minutes ago to what you're saying there, and how significant do you think that issue is?
I think internet poverty is quite significant. Citizens Advice Scotland...
I saw that's what it was had, tagged to. Yeah.
...had done a survey of... of internet poverty in deprived areas in Glasgow, and it's quite significant that in their study, 42% of the respondents to their study had never used the internet, which is quite a remarkable statistic when we think about it.
But how does that statistic compare with people in the court process? And really, what we're looking at here is how to use IT and that form of technology to improve the efficiency within the court process, rather than looking at general issues, which I have obviously across the Highlands and Islands, about access to the internet and broadband. And I just wondered if it's slightly confusing the issue here, because you sound, as I say in your verbal submission, very pro using IT, yet you use this caveat of the CAB issue about internet poverty.
Well, there's always a caveat, isn't there? I've got to give myself some wriggle room. But of course, the discussion which we've had about the evidence and procedure review and the use of IT in that connection is about court users such as my colleagues here and the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service itself. But I think going forward, if we're looking at the engagement of victims and witnesses, then you can see that the application of technology, particularly when there are court closures across the country, it could allow greater participation by people in that group. And that, I think, is where we were aiming to have the caveat. It's about how technology is used right across the board. There'll be a high use by those who are actually engaged in the justice system on a day-to-day basis, solicitors, procurators, fiscal, advocates, deputies and such. For those whose engagement is more periodic, then we've got to up the game there, I think, and that is where the reference to internet poverty comes about.
Waiting very patiently, John, then Rona, and then Mary.
Thank you, Convener. It's a question specifically for Mr. Manifield about what you referred to as a notable minority of cases, Mr. Manifield. And it's about the issue of disclosure, and you relate a situation where there may be two statements noted from someone, the disclosure of the evidence that's less than helpful to your client, subsequently to find that there is beneficial evidence that's not been disclosed. That seems very sinister and worrying.
I don't think it's as sinister as it might appear at first blush. I suspect that there is a natural focus on the part of the police and thereafter the COPFS to ingather what might be considered helpful prosecution evidence.
But that flies in the face of the disclosure of all evidence, beneficial or otherwise, that police officers have to go by.
Just to continue in what I was saying, I don't think there is a lack of willingness to provide exculpatory evidence where it exists, but because of the scarcity of resources, and again, I'm speculating because that's... I'm not part of the prosecution system, but there seems to be often a situation where crimes are investigated, certainly in less serious cases, up to the point where it's necessary, or the standard and the quality of evidence and quantity of evidence which is required to prove a crime or potentially to prove a crime has been met. That's disclosed, and then thereafter, if there are any inquiries to be made in relation to a defence position, that's left to the defence. I mean, a specific example of that might be where a suspect is interviewed by police prior to being charged, and during the course of that interview, they might, as not always the case, but they might actually lay out their position, which may incorporate an alibi, or we were the person might, in the case of an assault, say that they were defending themselves, and the information which is provided by the accused isn't very often followed up by the police in terms of an investigation, unless it's potentially useful to the prosecution in disproving what the accused might have said, for example, in terms of an alibi. So, as is the case with most of the criticisms that's been made of COPFS during the course of the written and verbal submissions, I suspect it largely lies with staffing and resourcing issues. I wouldn't like to cast doubt on the integrity of the prosecution service. That's where I suspect the problem lies.
Are you casting doubt on the Police Scotland?
Or indeed Police Scotland, I'm referring to...
Because you also go on to say that when you make inquiries of COPFS about issues, that comes back in the form of a memo rather than a statement, and memos are not necessarily disclosed.
Now, that's a fairly narrow issue, I would have to say. I think it was important to raise it during the course of the submission. It's not a common feature of prosecution cases. It might come down to the time that police officers have available, because a memo is simply, as far as the prosecution is concerned, it's simply an email which is passed to them with a response from a police officer, whereas if a statement is to be provided, the officer will have to sit down and formally prepare a written statement that will have to be to go through the channels with COPFS and thereafter would be disclosed. It's, I suppose, a question of defence solicitors having a different assessment of what might be relevant to the defence than COPFS.
On one level, it would seem immaterial whether you call it a statement or you call it a memo. If it's information that's pertinent to the case, it should be disclosed to yourself.
I would agree with that, and the defence would agree with that, but I think it's if a formal witness statement is received into the Crown Office or a particular Procurator Fiscal's office, if a statement's received, that is a red flag that is something which should be disclosed, whereas if it comes in the form of an email, that's something which is, I know it seems like a narrow distinction, but that's just a response to a request for information and might not automatically be treated as something which should be disclosed, and that's where we have a difficulty. But I can't stress enough that is a fairly narrow issue within the broader problems that there might exist in.
The fiscals when they come?
Yes, indeed. I was just going to ask, has that been specifically followed up, perhaps, if it's a very local issue or very pertinent? You said you did use the term notable minority.
Well, as luck would have it, Mr. Finney, I'm actually scheduled to have a meeting on behalf of the association with our local COPFS management later on today, so it's something I will be following up with them.
Many
very
thanks
pertinent
indeed. Okay, thank you.
Rona?
Perhaps,
on. Oh, well, it certainly will do.
Thank you.
Rona?
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, I was quite concerned to read, I think it was Edinburgh's submission about the issue of whether non-appearance warrants should be enforced by police officers or not. And you explained that historically, if there was a good reason, cops would arrange an appointment, an invitation, and set a date. And this has been stopped, so it involves, you know, vulnerable people getting arrested, basically.
We were advised some time ago, I can't put an exact time frame on it, but certainly more than a year ago, that the practice of offering invitation warrant appearances was being brought to an end. Now, I think that certainly has by and large proven to be the case, and it might be that the Crown reached the view or reached the decision to stop doing them because they felt that unreasonable requests were being made, and perhaps, and again this is speculation, but a fairly educated speculation, I hope, it might be that they were having too many requests to deal with, but we've now gone too far the other way. I mean, I think it's probably fair to say that now and again, and I have to stress now and again, the odd invitation appearance might be offered, but far too often the response that you're met with is, I'm sorry, there is a policy, we don't do that.
Okay. Well, what's the time scale? When did this start happening?
Over a year ago. I'm sorry, I can't be more clear than
does
that.
Does it amount to a significant number of cases where that happens?
Oh, yes, absolutely. Uh-huh.
Okay.
I mean, it's a regular problem faced by defence agents and people who are the subject to warrants of the nature that are described in the submission. Mm-hmm. And when I was seeking the views of the members of the association in advance of preparing the written submission, it's something that was raised on a number of occasions. So it's a problem, or certainly we would describe it as a problem.
Okay, thank you.
Mary?
Thank you, Convener, and I will be very brief. I wanted to come back to a comment, Mr. Manifield, that you made earlier when you spoke about the rigid policy in relation to domestic abuse cases. And I just wondered, is the rigid policy only applicable to domestic abuse cases, or are there other crimes or types of crimes that are subject to this same kind of rigid policy?
Well, that's a very good question, if you don't mind my saying. The reference is made in our submission, or our written submission, to, for example, offences which have a racial element of some kind. Other categories of case which I think are included in the same bracket would be where there is an allegation involving prejudice against sexual orientation or religious persuasion of one type or another. I was quite careful in the way that I phrased in the written submission what the policy was. I call it a stated policy rather than a published policy. But I think it's fairly common across the country that if you were to approach a depute about a case involving one of those types of behaviour, and you were able to point to good evidential reasons why it wouldn't be in the public interest for the case to proceed, or to go back to the example I gave much earlier on, the case of the 70-year-old man who'd never been in trouble, the response that you would receive is, "I'm sorry, my hands are tied, you know the policy in these cases." If you get as far as, or when you get as far as a hearing from COPFS, there might be an issue of when is a policy not a policy. They have, as I understand them, guidelines, but the consequences for people making a decision which isn't in accordance with those guidelines, and when I say people, I mean Procurator Fiscal's depute, they wouldn't be treated very kindly if they hadn't prosecuted in line with the guidelines, which amount to the policies which I've described.
You wouldn't be treated kindly by whom?
Their superiors.
Okay. And the consequences of that would be?
Well, that would be speculation on my part, but I do refer in, or we refer in our submission to a sort of a fear culture, and reference is also made to the short-term contracts that are offered to certainly young Procurator Fiscal's deputy. I think it's natural that if you are constantly concerned with the renewal of your contract, then there is a natural inclination or disinclination to not following guidelines.
Okay. Thank you for that.
I might add that the impact of the perhaps perceived lack of discretion is, from the accused point of view, also is that they will then just proceed to trial, you know, with on a narrow point, which perhaps if the exercise of discretion could have been made, would have saved the trial altogether. So I'm not saying that there shouldn't be protocols and guidelines. And I think, as I said earlier, perhaps if the deputes and the defence agents were aware of the level of seniority which has to be applied before that decision can be taken, because we sometimes find ourselves in the very difficult position of saying to a very respected but young colleague, "Would you mind terribly if I try to go above your head?" Which seems like professional discourtesy when you greatly respect their abilities, to try and identify who it is you should be approaching. And I wonder if I might be permitted to say that, you know, the anxiety of these cases is also applicable to the accused, that these are very complex cases to prepare, cases involving aggravation, sexual offences, child witnesses, and it might be that in due course the Justice Committee would widen their inquiry in terms of the wider criminal justice system and the resourcing available both for the defence also in respect of the very difficult and complex cases which defence agents are dealing with.
I'm very conscious of time. There's one area we haven't covered, the Inspectorate of Prosecution in Scotland. Little known independent statutory inspectorate, because a lot of the submissions have said they're not aware of it or they don't have a comment. However, there are some helpful comments about possibly increasing the effectiveness from the Law Society. I wonder if you could perhaps talk to these, please, Michael.
Certainly, Convener. We haven't had much contact with the Inspectorate. I think, and when I say that, I'm using the word much advisedly. When looking at the legislation on this, surely it was a good idea to create such a body, but we thought in looking closely at it that there would be ways to improve transparency and independence, and bringing on board non-procurators, fiscal or COPS employees, it would be a good way to do things. There is a memorandum of understanding from February 2014 between the HM Chief Inspector of Prosecution in Scotland, the Director General of Justice at the Scottish Government, and the Lord Advocate, and I think that behoves us to be aware that the Inspectorate exists, that issues its reports to the Lord Advocate, and I think there may be advantages to a broader appreciation of its role. Mm-hmm.
Terms and conditions and appointment being transparent, for example.
Indeed.
And perhaps the Lord Advocate is under no statutory duty at present to consider the recommendations. Perhaps that's something else that...
I'm sure the Lord Advocate does consider them, I'm sure the Lord Advocate would act on something which the Inspectorate found to be worrisome. I think we live in a much more transparent world nowadays than before. Just as much as transparency has shone a light on other areas in the justice system, this is another area which might benefit from it. And just before I leave that point, there was talk of post-legislative scrutiny, and this could fall easily into that bracket. And certainly when Mr. Stevenson chaired the Procedure, Standards and Appointments Committee, there was an examination of the legislative procedure process, we were very much in favour of post-legislative scrutiny at that point, and we remain so, and at the risk of giving the Parliament more work to do.
Mm-hmm. I think we're very keen to do post-legislative, so we welcome that suggestion. I have let this session run on because your submissions really were so helpful. I wanted to get as much as possible on the record. Can I thank you all very much for attending? It's very much appreciated. And with that, the next meeting of the committee will be on the 1st of November, when we will continue taking evidence from the Crown on the Crown and Procurator Fiscal Inquiry, and we'll also have an evidence session on the future of the British Transport Police in Scotland. And we now move into private session, and I suspend the meeting to allow the public and official report to leave the room.